Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Seth Hartman, and I am the representative of the Barclay Institute. I am a family-oriented scholar-athlete that has always had a passion for basketball and track and field. I aspire to be a civil engineer, and I plan on doing so next year at the illustrious Morgan State University. A quote that I hold dear to my heart is, hard work beats talent when talent fails to work hard. And I hope that shows tonight. So with that being said, thank you so much for coming, and please enjoy the show.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jaden Coleman, and I am this year's representative for the Bermuda Institute of Seventh-day Adventists. Here, I served as the head boy and student association treasurer. In the future, it is my goal to become an accountant, focusing in finance with multiple certifications under my belt. And in the words of my favorite author, Orson Scott Card, the wise are not wise because they make no mistakes. They are wise because they correct their mistakes as soon as they recognize them. Thank you all for coming out tonight. Enjoy the show.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dequan Trutt. I am 17 years old, and I am representing Cedar Ridge Academy. My favorite Bible verse is Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ that gives me strength. And with that, as a devoted Christian, I am deeply passionate for the arts. I aspire to become a film director one day or a film actor, and also open up my own film company here in Bermuda, giving youth another job in the arts field. So, thank you for supporting us this evening, and I know you will enjoy this show.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Keanu Rollins, and I'm here today representing Chatmore British International School. When I finish high school, I will attend college to study computer science to become a software engineer. I would like to someday start my own IT business on game development. Thank you for coming out this night, and I hope you enjoy the show.
Good evening. My name is Vincent Darrell, and I am proud to be the 2021 Alpha Boat for Soltis Grammar School. In September, I will be head prefect as well as Darrell House captain. I am a well-rounded student who has competed locally and overseas in public speaking as well as athletics. Public speaking has helped mold me into the outspoken young man I am today and has led me to find my passion for acting. As a 17-year-old entrepreneur who will be starting my clothing line, Pressure Till We Perish, this month, a quote that I hold dear to my heart is by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. You do not have to see the whole staircase. Just take the first step. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming this evening, and I hope you enjoy the show.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Xavier Ramsey, and I am the 2021-2022 head boy of Warwick Academy. I am aspiring towards a degree in biology as well as a career in the medical field. I hope to one day become a pediatrician so that I can help others within my community. If you don't already know me, I would describe myself as a hardworking and intelligent young man. One of my favorite quotes is this by Maya Angelou: if you don't like something, change it. If you can change it, change your attitude. I thank all who have come to support me tonight, and I hope you enjoy the show. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. We'd like now like to call the president to do his speech.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I said good evening. How is everybody? All right. I am Anthony Wade. I'm the current president of the Epsilon Theta Lambda chapter of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. Welcome to our 20th annual Alpha Beautillion. Tonight, you will experience six outstanding Bermudian treasures: Jaden, Vincent, Seth, Xavier, Keanu, and Daquan. All are outstanding young men who have spent the last year being mentored by our brothers and community partners under the extraordinary challenges of the COVID-19 pandemic. I have spent a few hours with these young men, and they are extraordinary. What you will witness tonight is Bermudian excellence in our youth. Their future is bright, and their best days are ahead of them. Thank you to all of our sponsors and community partners, some of whom wish to remain anonymous. Please refer to my remarks in the program for specific mentions. We would not have been able to put on this program without your support. Can I get a round of applause, please, for our sponsors? Thank you. Parents in the audience and also supporters of the young men, I want to thank you for lending us, and I'm calling them your sons, thank you for lending us your sons this past year. Your support has been immeasurable and has not gone unnoticed. They will continue to make you proud. Can I have a round of applause for our parents, please? I also would like to thank all of our sponsors and community partners. I think I said that already, so I'm gonna leave that alone. Let's go to finally. And that is, I want all of the Beautillion members to please join me on stage. We have one of you that I would like to recognize. Beautillion committee members. I don't want to start calling names. Okay, come on up. Brother Burroughs, Brother Williams, I know you're back there because I just saw you. Okay. All right. Okay, thanks. I've been told that all the rest are on their post. So, Brother Williams, you have led this committee for many years, and you've been an outstanding leader of the Beautillion program. In fact, you have led from the front, and you have done and dealt with some very challenging situations. You've helped us raise money. I mean, we could not have put this program on without your dedication. And so I want to recognize you tonight and just give you a small token of our appreciation for your dedication to our chapter generally, and also to our Beautillion program specifically. Audience, one of the things that you should know about Brother Williams is that he is an accomplished lawyer, first of all, by profession, but he is also a former winner of this competition, and I don't want to, of the first Alpha Beautillion, and so that was 20 years ago. So that will give you some inkling of his age. He has also been a Brother of the Year for our chapter. And so with that said, Brother Williams, I want to thank you for all of your excellent work. You have done well, and I wish you all the best in your future endeavors as you step down from this particular post.
Good evening again, ladies and gentlemen. I wasn't really expecting that, but I'm humble and I appreciate the gesture from the president, Brother Anthony Wade. I can't really see anyone at the moment, but how many of you here are here for the first time? So everybody else's hands down is repeat attenders, I suppose. Now, for those that are here for the first time, this is the 20th annual Alpha Beautillion program. 20 years. I did some quick maths, and over those 20 years, there have been approximately, I think about $240,000 in scholarships that have been allocated to the over 190 students that have participated in the Beautillion program. And obviously, the Beautillion program could not be a success without the repeat attenders and the newcomers. So give yourselves a round of applause for coming out to support these young men. And most importantly, we have a number of sponsors that have been generous to us over the years. This year, our sponsors are Deloitte and the Department of Youth, Sports, and Recreation and the Bermuda Community Foundation. But over the years, we've had countless sponsors that have been able to contribute to ensure that this program can continue and continue to be a success, and the Brothers of Alpha can continue to make an impact into the lives of our young high school juniors and seniors. About 2018 or 2019, I think it's 2018, I came across our MC for the night. He's a former student of the Barclay Institute. And I'm going to be back and forth because obviously we're concerned about numbers, so I'm going to be back behind the stage, dealing with those persons that you've came to see and to encourage tonight, but I'll also be out front again as well. I'm going to ask Mr. Antoine Jones to come out, and he's going to be your MC for the night. If you can give him a round of applause. You were a beau in 2018?
Yes.
Yes, Antoine was a beau in 2018. I'm not going to steal the thunder. I'm going to let him talk about himself, but I can say that when he was a beau, I definitely enjoyed the experience of getting to know him and to just see him grow into the young man that he is today, and I'm grateful for his contribution in coming back and to participate in this year's Alpha Battalion program. And without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to your MC for the night. You might have seen him on TV before, so if he's acting shy, I'm going to try and loosen him up a bit so he's not as shy. He's definitely a TV personality. You might recognize him, and I'm going to hand it over to him. Clap him on.
Good evening once again, ladies and gentlemen. How are you doing tonight? How are you feeling? I need you guys to talk to me. I'm here to talk to you. You're here for the guys tonight. So how are you doing tonight? How are you feeling? All right, I love it. So firstly, I'd like to say welcome once again to the 20th annual Alpha Battalion. It's such a pleasure to be here. It's amazing to be back on stage. I must say it's been a minute. So I need to find out who's in the house, right? Okay. So before we get to that, I'm gonna let you guys in on a little secret, but we're gonna see who's in the house first. So I need to see who's representing Warwick Academy tonight. All right, all right. Okay, Chatmore British International. All right, now look, we're trying to make people outside hear us, okay? So if you're representing, I need to know. So Soltis Grammar School? Okay. And they're trying to hear you backstage as well too. So just remember that. Cedar Bridge Academy. Oh my. Let's put this down. So what about Bermuda Institute? And of course, I had to save the alma mater for last. What about the Barclay Institute? I love it. I love it. I love it. You guys are showing out. Thank you. This is what we need because the guys backstage need to hear you. So I just want to talk a little bit about the actual Alpha Battalion program. So like Dante said, I participated in 2018. It was a blast. I must say that me and the guys are like brothers now. You know, this program helps to shape us into well-rounded individuals. At the time, I was doing my TV program, but I still wasn't getting out there and interacting with a lot of my friends and people my age at the time. So this helped me to really make some new friends at the time and also learn some more public speaking skills. And it was really just a great opportunity to become a very more well-rounded individual. So if your sons are in this program tonight, it's such a blessing, and I really want you guys to just support them all the way through. It's been a lot of hard work for them, I can imagine, but they're excited to come out on stage tonight, trust me. So I just want to break it down a little bit first about how we're going to be doing the scoring tonight, and why not a better time than to introduce our judges for the evening. So firstly, judges are here in the front, of course. And as we call them, or they can turn around and wave to you guys, let you know that they're here. So we have Jonathan White. Give him a nice round of applause. We have Takia Saunders. Amazing. We have Lindsay Simons. And we have Gainette Jones. All right, so it's gonna be a great competition tonight, and I just wanna break down how we're actually doing the scoring. So it's gonna go by ad sales, the essay writing, of course, decorum, attendance, community service, and also the overall participation in the program. So of course, I want you guys to enjoy the show this evening. I'm gonna be walking you through, I'm gonna be hyping you guys up, so I need you to make as much noise as possible as you can to show your support. Like I said, they need to hear you backstage. They need to hear you outside. So we're going to show out tonight. Is that right? Yeah. Look, cup match is coming up. I told you guys I'm going to let you in on a little secret, okay? So, like I said, I'm from the Barclay Institute, yeah. Right? Okay, had to just throw that in there again. Who are we supporting for cup match? No, I can't say my team because then you guys might think I'm too biased for sure. So look, just how you made all that noise just now, I need you to make that much noise for our boys. Thank you so much. Let's make some more noise for them. We're gonna have a quick video and then they're gonna be coming out once again to speak to you. Come on, let's clap them on.
So let me know what you're gonna say. Say it and then recap. So the organization of your speech still has to be there. But I thought it was good. I like symmetry and motion. I would have paused there for dramatic pause because sometimes how we string words together take people to a place visually. So I thought that was good.
Imagine life without it. Take your heart, for instance. The impulses and nerves travel through your heart to the Purkinje fibers.
Acting is doing. So without doing, or in other words, without movement, you cannot truly act.
Basketball, like many sports around the world, is beautiful when it's played correctly. But what makes it beautiful for me is not the flash and the pizzazz. It's the little things that, when done all together, makes this game look like poetry in motion. Excuse the cliche.
You point your hips towards the goal, leg back, knees bent. As you bring your foot forward, suddenly, you become a statue.
If you're happy,
smiling, grinning, ear to ear, singing a mellow song down the street. Okay, I might go, might have a little bit of fun, but sing that
if you're happy and you know it.
All right, I just want to wish all the birds tonight who are competing good luck. They've put in the work over the past several months. We've seen them grow. We appreciate this process and we hope you're entertained, but good luck, birds.
I'd now like to introduce the prompt for this evening's oratorical portion. What is your vision of a post-COVID-19 Bermuda? Let's make some noise for our young men. We will now hear from Seth Hartman from the Barclay Institute.
Good evening. The COVID-19 pandemic has been one of, if not the most difficult situations that my generation has experienced. Other generations could say the same thing. And one could even go on to say that this will be the toughest situation that my generation will face in our entire lifetimes. It has ruined lives, it has damaged relationships, and it has changed so many people's perspectives on the world around them. Now, we are on track to reach a post-COVID Bermuda very soon, actually. But as I look around, I've noticed that nothing much has changed. There is still so much anger and division in so many ways around our island. It's almost as if the island put itself on pause, for a year and a half, and now we're back, just with masks. Now, what I'm saying may sound a bit grim, but it's because in all honesty, I am a realist. A realist is the person who understands what is real and what is possible, not to be confused with a pessimist, who are people who are inherently negative. Not like it's necessarily a bad thing, because in reality, pessimists often do outlive optimists. Which today, even as a young person, I have noticed that getting out of this pandemic has divided us as a country. It made me feel like we were in a civil war, vaccinated versus unvaccinated. People are being treated differently because of a poke in the arm and a piece of fabric across their faces. Former President of the United States, Woodrow Wilson, once said, "We cannot be separated in interest or divided in purpose. We stand together until the end." At one point, it seemed like it was borderline hysteria. I hated it. Misinformation flooded not only our island, but the entire world, because misinformation is everywhere we look. It's the world that we live in. It's the world that we created for ourselves. If you think about this pandemic, you can say that it's been more than just a pandemic. It's been a wake-up call for the whole world to say that the path that we're going down is the wrong one. We as a people are focusing on the wrong things. Why aren't we listening to that call? Now, I know you're still wondering what my main answer to the question, what do I want? What is my vision? In all honesty, what I want is simple, yet for the human race is strangely so difficult. My vision, even as a realist slash marginal cynic, is a Bermuda that is more together, a Bermuda that is unified. I want people to appreciate the time that they have on this earth, especially with the massive loss of life during this pandemic. I want people to appreciate the time that they have with their loved ones, because they don't know when those loved ones could turn away and never come back. Those are the moments that matter in life. Those are the moments that are real. I want people to open their minds to the big picture. The things that we struggle with day to day are minute, and for lack of a better word, petty. Racism, misogyny, discrimination. This pandemic is a shining example that things can change in an instant. And I know we have a long way to go for this point, and it's harder than it sounds, but it starts with us individually. It starts with Xavier Ramsey, Vincent Darrow, Jaden Coleman. It starts with Dequan Trott, Keanu Rollins. It starts with me, Seth Hartman. Even world-renowned leader Nelson Mandela says, part of building a new nation means building a spirit of tolerance, love, and respect amongst the people of this country. We have been through so much as a country, and we have already been through so much, and we will have our challenges as a country, but we have already been through so much. So why can't we stand together, heart to heart, strength to strength? Life on this earth is finite. There are limits to what we could do in this world. But to push those limits, we must push together. In my post-COVID Bermuda, in my post-COVID world, we must push together. And we will continue to push and push and push until we find ourselves back on the path. The path that we all know we need to get back on. A path that we maybe haven't even found yet. As one. One people, one country, one Bermuda. Thank you.
Very well spoken. Let's bring it together once again for Seth Hartman. We will now hear from Jaden Coleman from the Bermuda Institute. I'm sorry.
Good evening, everyone. Did you know that 1 in 4 adults will experience some form of mental illness in their life? In a post-COVID-19 world, a learning curve must be established. It has taken a pandemic to bring the topic of mental illness to the forefront of our society. But now that it has become commonplace, how do we ensure that we keep this momentum? The post-COVID-19 Bermuda I envision is one where people feel comfortable talking about their mental well-being and seeking out the support when they need it. As a community, we have a duty to require a change. There needs to be improved awareness, more treatment options, and the eradication of labels and stigmas. Here's why. COVID-19 has paved the way for people to seek help. It has shown that all people can and will be affected in some way, shape, or form. Now, if any one of you had the ability to tell the future and told me a couple years ago, there's gonna be a pandemic and a mental health hotline is gonna be established, I'd never believe it. But look, here we are. The Mental Health Hotline and the Medline Plus website detailing mental illnesses are positive and important pathways to understanding and normalizing mental health. But quite frankly, it is not enough. The future I envision includes multiple community groups that educate and provide support. A community that is knowledgeable about the resources available and is not ashamed to use them, as well as a future where mental health is not a setback, but rather a stepping stone into one's deeper self-awareness. Now, when I say depression, what is the first thing that comes to your mind? How about schizophrenia? Are you afraid? Do you have an image of someone in your mind? What if I told you that your doctor was a person diagnosed with bipolar disorder? Would that change how you trusted his advice? In actuality, there are persons with mental differences all around us. That same doctor diagnosed with bipolar disorder has the potential to be just as, if not more, knowledgeable than a doctor who is considered normal. But I can see from the look of some of your faces that this just makes you pause. However, let's stop and think. If 1 in 4 have a mental illness, then that means you are 100% patronizing the services of at least few such individuals. It may be your doctor, your lawyer, or the airline pilot from your last vacation. How would you truly know how to differentiate their services or abilities? Some may believe that having a mental illness limits what a person can do or accomplish. However, when we take the time to focus on the potential positives, we can see the benefits of diversity right in front of us. Autism is a spectrum that can be associated with intellectual brilliance, while schizophrenia can be associated with creativity and artistic ability. Since the time of Plato, who spoke of divine madness, and Aristotle, who noted that creative people tended toward melancholia, it has been known that the tension between order and disorder within the brain creates the ideal place for genius. It is these positive portrayals that I want to see in a post-COVID-19 world, a Bermuda that acknowledges our differences and celebrates our uniqueness. As a citizen, I was proud that my government took the initiative to establish the hotline for mental health. They consistently reinforced the importance of seeking help and provided ways in which that help could be found. I would love to see them capitalize on the opportunity to establish wraparound services and further promote community-based interventions. There is a real opportunity for the government to support non-institutional-based care and further promote the normalization of mental health services at the grassroots level. Today, in this post-COVID-19 Bermuda, let us continue to build on the foundation of this pandemic's public health response and embrace this heightened awareness of the importance of our collective mental health. You do not have to wait years until someone you know or love has experienced mental illness. By taking a stand today, we can shift a new approach to effectively support future generations. And for those of you who may be struggling with an illness, in the words of John Green, there is hope even when your brain tells you there is not. Thank you.
I'm telling you, they work very hard for you tonight. Let's give it up once again for Jaden Coleman. Okay. And next, we will hear from Daquan Trott from the Cedar Bridge Academy.
Good evening. Dear Mr. Premier, Nelson Mandela once said, children are our greatest treasure. They are our future. As the youngest premier ever known, you must understand why the voice of the youth should be heard. I understand that I am Bermuda's tomorrow, but my future vision of a post-COVID Bermuda right now is not unity in numbers, but division in our streets. I can tell you what I hope Bermuda would look like after COVID. Though unfortunately, I can also tell you what we would look like if you, the government, continue to control this country in this unwavering manner. Unfortunately, hopes have and will be hindered. Trusts will be broken and discrimination will be fully accepted. As a recent graduate, I embrace the dream of achieving success. And I'm sure many other young Bermudians embrace this very same dream. We all at least have some form of support system, a group of people to encourage us, to uplift us, to reflect of us when we need it the most. So if I come back home from continuing my destiny in college and want to enjoy Christmas with my family before heading back off to college, that might not happen because most of my time will be spent in a hotel and all because I choose not to take a vaccine. I have friends who would love to return home right now, but cannot return because they do not have the sufficient funds to pay for hotel quarantine. This is present concerns, but a post-COVID Bermuda might be a place where the youth do not return home anymore because their country cannot understand the choice not to take a vaccine. We are your future. So if we don't trust you, who will be the ones to hold this country together in the not so distant future? There is no trust without us. Us being every single Bermudian that calls this place their home. Bermuda is a democratic country. So when the people cry out for change, they should not be ignored. If a leader does not listen to his or her followers, trust becomes absent. According to the Democracy Fund organization, there are two types of trust. Cognitive trust, which is conveyed as trusting from the head, and affective trust, which is conveyed as trusting from the heart. Many Bermudians no longer trust from the head or from the heart. And because of this distrust, feeling unsafe is a constant feeling. Who wants to live in a society where you think your voice is unsafe or unheard? A Bermuda where discrimination is accepted and distrust is gleaming through our streets, where unity is only a wish and is not a basic quality of our culture anymore. Being a part of the youth as the future of tomorrow, my voice is equal to any other voice in this country. We say the youth don't use their voices, but I am using it now because it should be heard. I thought we were a nation of unity and love, but now all I see is division and beliefs are being crushed. For a Bermudian to voice their personal opinion is a fundamental right. See, Chapter 1 of the Bermuda Constitution is about the protection of fundamental rights and freedoms of the individual. It states that every person in Bermuda is entitled to the fundamental rights and freedoms of the individual. That is to say, has the right, whatever his race, place of origin, political opinions, color, creed, or sex, but subject to respect for the rights and freedoms of others and for the public interest. So when one does not want to take a vaccine, that is a choice, and we should not discriminate against that. See, when a person is diagnosed with cancer, the doctor will ask if the person wants to go into treatment or not. And if that person says no, by no means necessary can the doctor go against that person's wishes and force them to take the treatment. So, Mr. Premier, you cannot do that either. This is not hate speech, but a speech to ensure that the next generation of Bermudians will not grow up in a society that discriminates against others for personal choices. We are perceived by many as a praying nation, who stick together in times of uncertainty, who acknowledge the importance of togetherness. But not at this moment. Mr. Premier, I hope the pathway you continue to take does not obstruct dreams from taking flight or cause trust between civilian and government to cripple. But most importantly, I hope it does not allow for non-immunized persons to be looked at less than others. We have faced many hardships before, and we have fought together to pursue goodness for our nation. And now is not the time to forget about that togetherness. There is a chant or phrase that I'm sure you may know, Mr. Premier. It is, united we stand, divided we fall. And as I am your treasure for tomorrow, please ensure that a post-COVID Bermuda is not a nation of separation, but only a country who has progressed as one through our world pandemic. Sincerely,
your future.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm loving this so far. I'm telling you, it's gonna be a tight one. Let's hear some more noise. Make some more noise for that. Okay, next up, we will hear from Keanu Rollins from the Chatmore British International School. Let's make some noise for Keanu.
Good evening, everyone. My vision of a post-COVID Bermuda is that we will be back to some normalcy, but with a few restrictions and regulations. These will be put into place to stop and prevent the spread of COVID. One of the biggest things that we will have to do after we minimize and clear our COVID problem is to continue getting tested and quarantine and implement new security measures to stop the spread of COVID, especially if we are coming back from a foreign country that has not yet cleared its COVID problem. Some things might become normal in a post-COVID Bermuda that we was doing during COVID, such as online school, a limited amount of people in stores, restaurants, and other establishments, and wearing masks in certain places such as the hospital. One of the biggest problems that COVID has created is that it has affected our economy in a bad way. Many people have lost jobs and businesses have lost money. That resulted in the government losing money by giving out stimulus checks to people that were not working. Remote working is more likely to be common. This is because there is evidence to support that working from home is just more productive than working in the office. However, many companies were reluctant to try this until COVID came. Now that companies have tried it, remote working might be here to stay for the companies that have had success during these times. Some parents might even keep their children in online school if they are doing better and it is more convenient for them. Many stores and buildings would be much cleaner to stop the spread of COVID or any other virus since this pandemic. These buildings will still have hand sanitizer or any other cleaning products at the front entrance in a post-COVID Bermuda. People would perform better hygiene practices such as washing their hands, covering sneezes or coughs. And many people might start bringing their own hand sanitizer or other cleaning products with them before they leave the house. Many people that have caught COVID-19 might be affected in a post-COVID Bermuda. There have been studies done to show that there might be some long-term COVID effects. These effects can range from chest pain, coughing, shortness of breath, memory loss, and headaches. The main ones that people are getting are feeling fatigued and stressed, and many of these studies have resulted. This stress in many of these studies have resulted in loss of hair and many other problems. As COVID in Bermuda is being resolved, we will have to work together to fix the long-term effects such as the economy, jobs, and even schools. As the COVID problem is being resolved in Bermuda, we will have to work together to fix the long-term effects that COVID has affected on our economy, jobs, and even schools. We will have to work together to get back to the normalcy that we want and that we need. Thank you.
I'm loving how these young men are just approaching the issues, and I'm really looking forward to a post-COVID-19 Bermuda as well. Of course, next up, we will hear from Vincent Darrell from the Soltis Grammar School. Let's make some noise.
Oh, shoot, I forgot my mask. More than likely, we've all been in this situation when leaving home. Although this has been the reality and the new norm globally, there still lies a vision for post-COVID innovation through entrepreneurship and education. Firstly, to shape a vision for the future, it is important to acknowledge what has already been achieved. Through implementing COVID-19 protocols in Bermuda, we're on a path to reducing the spread of infections and creating a safe environment. Through panel discussions, we've been able to identify concerns and provide education to residents. In addition, through making the vaccine easily accessible, Bermuda has made great strides. As a result, Bermuda has been able to administer over 82,000 doses of the COVID-19 vaccines, equating to vaccinating over 64% of our population. Due to our work as an island, this year, many schools were able to hold physical graduations, allowing family members to attend. This summer, more day camps resumed, and students are engaging in internships and work experiences. Moving forward, I also imagine that we'll continue to experience events such as the Eastern County Games and the Beautillion, but instead, these will be safe key events. Although this may initially be hard for us to adjust to, I believe for us to return to some sort of normality, these protocols are necessary as it mitigates the risk of COVID-19 infections. We hope that these measures lead us back to the freedoms that Bermuda once enjoyed. Our progress as an island has been extremely beneficial to our economy as we've lifted curfews and allowed overseas travel and more frequent flights. Adam Grant, author of Think Again, stated, "If knowledge is power, knowing what we don't know is wisdom." With that in mind, as we yearn for a sense of relief, my vision for a post-pandemic Bermuda lies on three key principles. Small businesses and entrepreneurs who are open to change and were able to display adaptability and resilience during times of adversity will thrive post-COVID. For example, Sargasso Sea, a Bermuda on-demand virtual market, which launched in January 2019, demonstrated the proverb, "Where there lies a problem, there lies an opportunity." With this knowledge, Sargasso turned the problem of not being able to interact physically with merchants once the pandemic struck and introduced a delivery service with access to an online marketplace and safe practices. It is essential that businesses learn from this experience and embrace opportunities for change. We can already see enormous growth in technology. For example, the use of QR codes instead of physical menus that can enhance safety and is environmentally friendly. Secondly, I believe that a post-COVID-19 Bermuda will embrace learning that is more blended and gives students new opportunities for knowledge acquisition. There will be balance between asynchronous and synchronous learning instead of the traditional lecture-based learning. This learning technique will encourage students to take a greater interest and responsibility for their learning and exercise self-discipline. In addition, asynchronous learning allows for flexibility and enables students to work independently instead of under the teacher's time constraints, which is more effective for students who may take longer to process information, like myself. This shift in strategy gives pupils a greater sense of freedom and belief that they can succeed. Thirdly is the belief that while we cannot predict what the future holds or perhaps visualize that whole staircase, we can succeed at taking the first step. And the second, in reshaping our thinking, reassessing our priorities by not losing sight of everything else that matters in life that is not COVID-19 related. For instance, animal cruelty and the environment. Ladies and gentlemen, we can be proud of how Bermuda has stepped up to the challenge of the pandemic and has been optimistic about the vision for our future. We can see our efforts to return to some sort of normalcy and also how entrepreneurs and educators who have turned moments of adversity into opportunity for innovation will thrive in a post-pandemic world. Lastly, we can be comforted in the knowledge that while the future may look a little different than what we imagined, by also addressing non-COVID-19 issues that affect humanity. Now, before I leave the stage, where's my mask? Thank you.
And since we're talking about the future, I must say it is looking very bright, ladies and gentlemen. Let's put our hands together once again for all the boos we've heard so far. And now we will hear from Xavier Ramsey from Warwick Academy.
Good evening. Learn from yesterday, live for today, hope for tomorrow. The important thing is to not stop questioning. Albert Einstein. If we are to explore and question what we wish our island of Bermuda to look like in the coming months and years after the COVID-19 pandemic has subsided, we must first acknowledge the positive and negative impacts that the pandemic has had. I'm going to ask you this. Close your eyes. Reflect. Look back on the past and highlight the aspects of Bermuda that you love. For me, I have always loved the sense of community that I felt around the island, no matter the location. Wherever I go, Bermudians will always greet you with open arms. This has allowed me to build many relationships in extremely short spans of time, such as the relationships I have created with my fellow Boers during these past few months. I cannot underestimate the value of the connections that I have made as we were able to feed off of each other and find some peace and enjoyment in the midst of exams, essays, and dozens of other tasks. That is one aspect that I feel has struggled to exist in this current pandemic environment. The health and safety protocols have been put in place for that very reason, to ensure the health and safety of Bermudians. However, the protocols have restricted our ability to connect with each other. I was extremely disappointed to hear that Cup Match would be taking place in a limited capacity this year, as a two-day event in many ways embodies Bermudian hospitality and passion towards our community. In my own school, I've wished that clubs and other programs could restart so that my peers could feel a greater sense of togetherness that has not been felt in a long time. Near the end of the school year, when I was finally able to attend the Black Affinity group at my school again, I caught a glimpse of how enriching the school environment can be. But this fantasy can only become a reality in the absence of health protocols. One hope that I have is that as the pandemic subsides, health protocols will follow, allowing for our culture to have room to flourish as it has in many years, bringing all communities of Bermuda into a greater sense of unity. This will allow us as a people to continue planning and innovating to create a Bermuda with greater social, economic, and environmental stability, preparing future generations of Bermudians for success. Now that we've looked at our past, let us look at the present. As hard as it is to believe, there have been positive impacts of the pandemic, even if they may be derived from negative aspects. For example, the topic of mental health. During the pandemic, people of all ages struggled to cope with the isolation that they felt during periods of shelter in place and anxiety due to the uncertainty that many faced in issues such as sudden unemployment and health concerns. This was felt on a domestic and international level, as the Kaiser Family Foundation found in a survey that 56% of young adult applicants have reported symptoms of anxiety and/or depressive disorder compared to older adults as of December 2020. Others took their time at home during shelter in place to reflect on their growth as an individual over the years and evaluate habits and behaviors that they could improve. In all these circumstances, the mental well-being of individuals was addressed, and there was a large influx of resources and information to teach people how to deal with their mental health. I was extremely happy to see this taking place, as I know that I have greatly benefited from the support of my school counselor over the past school year. Working with her gave me the chance to observe how crucial awareness for mental health is, not only for those dealing with subjects classified as serious, but also for the broader community. My hope is that this provision and awareness continues on a greater scale in Bermuda as more initiatives and programs become available and are actively used by the general public, such as the health scheme implemented at the Lamb Foger Urgent Care Clinic this year. This will allow greater accessibility and coverage to services that individuals may have not understood or been able to receive in the past. In conclusion, I believe that it is vital for us as a community to look at the past and the present for guidance on our future. Learning from our experiences during the pandemic can help us to create a better future that benefits us all, not just one group of individuals opposed to another. I believe that focusing on one topic at a time can allow us to thoroughly improve aspects of our community that are sometimes overlooked. My hope is that we use the time we have to make the change we can. I will try to do my part. I only ask that you do the same. Our impacts will not be identical, but as long as they are impactful, we are heading in the right direction. Thank you.
I love how the young men tonight have really touched on some serious issues and have also really brought the truth to light as well. Let's make some more noise for our boys this evening.
So ladies and gentlemen, we've reached the point in the program where you can contribute as well. The intermission. I know some of you might be a little peckish. We have a selection of foods outside available for you. We are asking that you consider contributing by way of a donation towards those foods that we have outside and waters and juices. Haven't you guys enjoyed the program thus far? These young men are remarkable. They have persevered, and I am excited that we are able to have the battalion this year. Last year was the first year, obviously, that we had COVID, and I went through that entire, it being the 19th annual Alpha Battalion and COVID-19, and it was on the 19th of July, and it was all these things that people might have thought it was superstitious, and because sometimes things mean something to people. But this year, the 20th year, these students had to go through COVID last year, and then had to go through COVID again this year, and then prepare for this battalion program. So I am extremely happy that they were able to pull it off. They've come up here and they've done a remarkable job. And once they finish the battalion program and when they finish university, I'm more excited about what they're going to give back to the community. Because I see six young men that are definitely anxious to come back into the community of Bermuda and serve, to be leaders as well. I was speaking with the young men before the program and I was talking about success. And you know, my mantra for success was always, it's not about you. Success is about what you can give to somebody else. So I'm hopeful that those that are listening by way of Facebook and Channel 82 and those here can obviously take these words that these young men have, take the examples that they're setting out here and realize that there's hope for the future of Bermuda, there's hope for our young men, and these young men and young men to come for next year's battalion are definitely going to be the future of Bermuda. With that being said, I'm going to let the ask if our judges can first, once they're finished, they can come outside, and then we will have the intermission. The intermission is about 10 to 15 minutes. I would say 10. Eat as much as you can without giving yourself indigestion, heartburn, or anything else, and come back. We have an exciting last portion of the show. So here's now your time to contribute. Donations and food.
Until the philosophy that holds one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned, I and I say there be one.
War, war, until there's no longer
My name is Seth Hartman. I go to the Barclay Institute. I am a deputy head boy and I'm Gold House captain. I feel like it's been a real good experience so far. Like getting to know this guy has been an interesting process. They're all cool guys, like it's nothing bad. It's always good vibes when we're together. Like I feel like we're connected pretty instantly when we all came together. I feel like I'm learning so much so far, like about myself, how like I present myself in public and learn how to speak. I feel like that's a whole new world for me because I'm always been a real like quiet introverted person. I'm very competitive, so it's always in the back of my mind. But at the same time, like I'm really just happy that I made these relationships in the first place. But like because I'm here, I'm still here again. So like I'm gonna come and I'm gonna like come bring my A game and I'm actually gonna work hard. I'm gonna put my work in because I'm not gonna come here and waste all my time, you know, for nothing. Hi everybody. I appreciate you. If you know that you was involved in this process with me, you already know that you appreciate it. So thank you so much. I'm trying my best for you. I'm representing for you. And yeah, I'm gonna bring it up.
My name is Jaden Combe and I'm the head boy at Bermuda Institute. And without a doubt, I will definitely say that when the night comes, yeah, we might all be friends, but tonight we're going for the win. And I would say to any future competitors, give it your best. If you feel like you can't do it, you'll never know until you actually join and do it. It is definitely a good experience to go through. And while you might not see the benefits while you're watching those of us who are competing now, when you become a part of it, you will definitely see the benefits. To my fellow competitors, hey, we might all be friends, but I'm going for that first spot. To all those that have been helping me along the way and supporting me and just giving me their best wishes, I'd just like to say thank you.
My name is Dequan Trott and I am head boy at Cedar Bridge Academy. It was kind of like, okay, I know these guys already, I can do this. And I feel like sometimes competition is good because it makes everyone do good, you know? And so the competition's there, but the friendship is also there. So that's what brings all of us up together. So when we get to the final night, it's not about just about who wins, but how we did it together, you know? So I think that's there for sure. But I think that COVID definitely limited us from doing the things that we would originally do in Alpha Battalion. But now I think that the phases of going through that, we now have the opportunity to bond with each other and different things like that. So that experience has been pretty good. On the camera, I'm a different person. You know, I'm the lights are on and everyone's looking. I'm ready. So they should be ready too. Yeah. Thank you, all my friends, my family, all my supporters out there in the crowd tonight. I just want to say, I hope to do my best and make you proud.
My name is Keanu Rollins and I attend Chatmore British International School and I am a senior. I got involved with the Alpha Battalion program by my school. They offered it to me. They offered it to me because they said I was excelling and they said I was the best fit for this program. My experience in the program so far has been good. It's taught me about leadership and definitely speaking. Well, the public speaking has probably been the hardest part about this program for me at least. It's because I'm a very shy person. I'm not loud, very soft talker. This program taught me how to be more confident and definitely has made me speak louder and more comfortable in public speaking. So we went to bowling. It was fun, Remy Van. We did foot golf and we done community service. I want to thank my supporters, especially my teachers and my school for supporting me to do this and my parents and family. And I would hope you enjoy the show.
my name is Vincent Darrow. I'm currently an SUI2 student at Soltis Grammar School, and I'm gonna be the head boy for the 2021-22 school year. If you're someone that knows what you want and in life and where you wanna see yourself in the next 5 years or so, this is definitely a good program to partake in. Even if you don't win, you learn a lot of good things from this and you just take a lot of good things away. Like if you're looking for personal development, this is a program that definitely assists you, and you definitely will create relationships in terms of networking and even with fellow Bows. Like, I look at these guys as brothers now. I came in this program like, I just want to win. But now I've actually literally created genuine relationships with these guys. So it definitely is a program that you should definitely take heed in. Well, I would just like to thank everyone who supported me along this journey. A lot of people know I've just grown as a person. And definitely, I'm going to do my best in this program. I'm going to put on a good show for everyone back at home. Shout out to my family, my mom, my aunt, my brother, everyone at school, my nana, my aunts, my cousins, and everyone. And we're going to do our best and hopefully secure this win. Let's go.
I'm Xavier Ramsey, and I'm the head boy of Work Academy. I mean, it's been pretty enjoyable experience just meeting all these guys. People that are like-minded to myself, it's interesting to have conversations and just to be genuine with each other. We may be in a competition, but I think it's a great opportunity for us to learn about each other and learn about our different careers and just have something that we could look forward to in the different weeks when we have our speeches and we can hear each other and encourage each other and things like that. Well, it's definitely going to be a lot of joking on the night, even though it's going to be underlined with some pressure. I think that as long as we continue to encourage each other, just to be genuine, show our skills, to just enjoy the night, then it'll be great. And I hope that we all do well. I don't want anybody to do badly. I want us to be able to show all that we can be. So just good luck to them. Everybody out there that's watching and supporting me in this competition, I really thank you for supporting me and helping me to know that somebody's there for me. You guys are a huge help to me.
All right, put your hands together. We're gonna have Xavier Ramsey. Please put your hands together for Xavier Ramsey, who's gonna be our first Bow in the talent portion tonight.
Dear Anonymous, I've been writing for a couple weeks now. The pen in my mind has nothing left to squeeze out. My letters are endless, more than I can pronounce. Complex ideas and stuff I consider renowned. Let me take you on a journey of a young man who's still kind of learning. And please, don't start getting worried. It's a process with progress emerging. Now, if you're a regular on this show, well, at least your topic has been mentioned before. It's all included in my endless lyrical flow. Should I say something that my conscience telling me no? Man, why not? I'm tired of feeling alone. You must forget. Does your memory need to reload? Just please stick to the small and narrow road. Don't settle, please. You deserve much better, bro. Why do I share these uncomfortable conversations? Because I know some of y'all are facing similar altercations. But these topics bring upon pathetic connotations, so people choose not to share their complications. Like me, you've tried to fit a mold for so long, trying to force something you can't force at all. Maybe if I push a little harder, I'll finally be involved. Maybe I'll finally be considered one of y'all. By one of y'all, I mean someone you admire, but your admiration has made you desire the acceptance of one and also require you to fit a mold in order to acquire. to acquire the love you think they'll give. Then they give that love, but it isn't it. And because you find that it isn't bliss, you end up wasting your hope in this. Please, stop thinking with a mindset like this. You are worth more than the Rolex that could be on my wrist. You just have to believe and let your confidence exist. Let it thrive by encouraging yourself instead of keeping yourself love upon the shelf. This mindset is not good for your mental health. Don't try to be someone else. Like my mama says, always be yourself. You'll feel much better once you free yourself from that self. You'll feel much better once you free yourself from that mental health. Now, my letters don't just talk about what my self-perception was. They also talk about my seamlessly endless flaws. My pursuit of perfection causes me to constantly pause. My mind labels me as the only logical cause. The cause of things I simply can't control, but my mind continues to unfold. My brain moving faster than Usain could ever bolt. Now I'm looking to heaven for a supernatural jolt. Heaven looks back down at me saying, man, it's not your fault. If it's not my fault or my cross to bear, take away these heavy chains that I do wear. Take away the times when I feel so ensnared. Take away the times when I feel so scared. For a long time, there was this pressure that existed. In my chest, in my mind, I simply couldn't dismiss it. I saw all my mistakes written in a book called The Imperfections Xavier Lives In. As a perfectionist, nothing was ever good enough for me. Not for me, but for the doubt my mind would breed. It's hard to be proud of yourself when all that you can see is a label of sinner permanently imprinted on your sleeve. Let me ask you, does that remind you of anything? Now, I'm not here to shove this great book in your mouth. I'm just here to share some advice for people like me that live in such great doubt. Ephesians 2, verses 8 through 9 says, "For it is by grace, sweet grace, that you have been saved. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no man can boast through faith." Grace from the Lord has kept me on my journey, and for me to say anything else would be like burning all the bridges he built to get me here and saying, no, I flew. It's just unfair. But you know what else is just unfair? For me to continue keeping you here. I hope you felt something like Shakespeare and you haven't just sat and stared. I hope I touched someone's ears and now someone else actually cares to be a little more loving and a little less scared, because the next person that is to come near might also be looking for something kind of rare. It's the love that they see you wear, because you can't find that everywhere.
I'm telling you that this is one of my favorite parts of the night, and after we're done with these talents, it's gonna be one of yours as well. So how are you feeling so far tonight? Yeah? Everyone's still in the house, right? Okay, we still got Warwick here, right? Okay, I'm gonna check in, don't worry. We're gonna make sure. So, coming up next, we have none other than Daquan Trott. Please make a warm welcome.
Places in my life and time, I've sung so many songs and I've made some bad rhymes. I've acted out my life.
life in stages. So many people watching, yeah. But we're alone now, and I'm singing this song to you. I love you, for there's no space or place in time. I love you for my life. You're a friend of mine, and when my life is over, remind me when we're together. But we're alone now, and I'm singing this song to you. But yet the thought of losing you's been hanging around my mind. Far more frequently you're weary perfume, and then you say no special place to go. But when I ask, will you be coming back soon? Never know, never know. 'Cause I'm a man of many wishes. I hope my premonition misses what I really feel. My eyes won't let me hide, 'cause they always start to cry. Ooh, 'cause this time could be goodbye.
So much talent. Don't we have so much talent here up on this stage? Put your hands together once again. Definitely. I'm loving it so far. How are you guys feeling? Just checking in with you. That was Cedar Bridge. Cedar Bridge is still here, right? All right. So coming up next, actually, before we even get to that, I want to just, parents, I know that you know it's been so much hard work going into these talents, right? Parents, a lot of hard work. So make sure you bring the noise, bring the support. We love it. They want to hear you backstage as well, too. Thank you so much for supporting so far. So coming up next, we have none other than Keanu Rollins from Chatmore British International School. Please put together.
Good evening, everyone. Today, I'm here to show you my passion and talent for coding. I learned my coding skills from watching videos, having a mentor, and attending coding camps in both Bermuda and America. One of my biggest coding accomplishments is getting in the newspaper for coding a thermometer and a robot. Many people don't know what coding is, so I will give you a brief explanation. Coding is the process of creating instructions for the computer using programming languages. There are over 700 of these languages, but for the game that I am showing you today, I have used a language called Python. This game took me about 1 to 2 weeks with 8 hours of work each day to create. Most of the time was spent on writing the code, creating the maps and the players. So the game can be functional. One of the hardest parts of writing the game was creating these projectiles. This is because I had to create multiple different versions of them and write multiple codes so they can have the effect of moving through the air, as you can see on the screen. And I will show you some of the code that I wrote for it. One of the best parts of the game is when I had written the code and created the doors. This is because it had brought the game together in all my work. As you can see, when I pass through the door, I go to the next level. This goes to show that the games that are even more simpler take time and effort to make. I would like to create even more games that are better and more complex someday and even publish them. Thank you for listening to my talent and hope you enjoy the evening.
That is amazing. Talk about a step ahead. Put your hands together one more time. I'm telling you, that is the future right there, because if you go on your phone, you use an app. If you're on any form of device, you're using apps, and games are the future, and so are apps. So I'm telling you, put your hands together one more time. I'm loving the talent so far. Okay, so for my talent portion, if I remember correctly, I done a spoken word. Was anybody there at the 2018 talent show? Yeah? I mean, Alpha Battalion, I'm sorry. Yes? That was an amazing night. And like I said before, it went by like this. So I know that these guys are enjoying it so far. So just remember to keep bringing the support, keep bringing the energy that you've been bringing so far. We love it. So coming up next, we have none other than Vincent Darrell from the Saltis Grammar School. Please put your hands together. Bring a warm welcome.
I used to be a very negative person. But then I took this personality workshop that totally turned my life around. Now when something bad or negative happens, I can see the positive. Now, when I have a really bad day or when someone I thought was a really good friend betrays me, or maybe when I've been hit by one of those damn people riding bicycles the opposite way on a one-way street, Anyway, I look at any of these things and I say to myself, this glass is not half empty, it's half full. Yes, yes. Or the people in the movie theaters who just talk endlessly during the opening credits, so you could just tired of gonna talk the entire movie. And it just makes no sense to ask them not to talk because they're probably just sending out vibrations that they hate you during the entire movie. But really, I've been trying to be a positive person. That's what I've been doing with my life lately. And it is very hard for me because I am very sensitive to the vibrations of people around me. Or maybe I'm just paranoid. You've probably experienced something similar. You know, the people in the subway who just keep staring at you, and you're the only two in the car, and he just keeps staring. And then you begin to think to yourself, does he want to kill me? Or is he just trying to intimidate me? Which is just annoying enough. You know, there's people in the movie theaters who just, you know, keep talking endlessly during the opening credits. There's people, because of them, I don't go to the movie theaters anymore. What's the point? But you could skip going to the movie theaters, but you pretty much have to go to the supermarket. I was in the supermarket the other day, about to buy some tuna fish, when I sensed this very disturbed presence right behind me. There was something about her presence, her focus, that made it very clear to me that she was a disturbed person. So I thought to myself, well, you should never look at a crazy person directly. So I thought, I'll just keep looking at these tuna fish cans, pretending to be engrossed in whether they're in oil and water. And the person would just go away. But instead, she brings her fist on right in my head and screams, would you move too? No, why did she do that? She hadn't even asked me, would you please move at some initial point so, you know, I know what our problem was. Admittedly, I don't always tell people what my problem is either. But I'll just go take my fist and go wham on their heads. I mean, analyzing it, looking at it in a positive light, this woman probably has some really horrible life story that, you know, if it was explained to me, I could have probably made some sense out of how she got to this point and hitting me in the supermarket. But even with that knowledge, which I didn't have, it was my hair she was hitting, and it's just totally unfair. It just makes me never, ever, ever, ever want to leave the house again. You know what? I probably need to stay inside, because if I stay inside, these people cannot mess with my blood pressure.
Thank you.
I'm telling you, I'm loving it so far. I'm getting a kick backstage there, and I'm got the best seat in the house. I'm sorry, guys. How you guys feeling? We're good? We've heard a lot of talent and we've seen a lot of talent tonight, starting from an amazing piece by Xavier Ramsey from the Warwick Academy. Come on. We had the Quan Trott singing a lovely voice. Come on, put your hands together from Cedar Bridge Academy. We had Keanu Rollins up here, a lot of talent, coding, amazing. It takes a lot of time to do that as well too. I'm telling you, are you guys ready for what's coming next? Okay, I'm gonna ask that again. Are you ready for what we have next. Who you think's coming next? Wait, say that again. From where? The Barclay Institute. Okay, please put your hands together for Seth Hartman from the Barclay Institute. Warm welcome.
Excuse me, Mama. Just, Mama! Mama, leave me alone!
Yeah, that's me. Yeah.
Yeah, you look pretty good. You know, I'm trying to get better at basketball. You know, can you help me out? Show me some moves, you know?
Yeah, I guess. Sure, I'll help you out, bro. Come on. Let's see. Okay. So you want to make sure that your base is nice and wide. Bend those knees, keep your chest up. Right? That's what I'm going to show you. Got that?
I don't know, man.
You practice that.
Excuse me.
What's up?
You gonna be here for long?
Yeah, probably.
Probably. While you're here, can you try something for me, quick? You got that? Try that. Why? Excuse me, no. You messed everything up. No, please, get away. Wait. Guys, can we do that one more time, please? One more time. Ready? Look, I'll lead you in one at a time. Look, you. Ready? Talked about this. Get
I think it went pretty much.
Go. All right, come on.
What's going on?
What?
I'm telling you, that was creative, wasn't it? I love that. No, if it's one thing that I didn't have was rhythm. So to see the drums, and you know, and then he hit the basketball, and then it was the broom. I'm saying, what? I don't know where I missed out. I'm saying that is wicked. Put your hands together one more time. Have you guys been enjoying the talent so far? What about the show? Has it been amazing so far? Let them know. Have you been enjoying the show so far? Now, I've been watching our judges too, just making sure they've been keeping the scores in order. So don't worry, everything's looking good, okay? Got the tunnel vision. All right, so last but not least, I would love to introduce to the stage, Jaden Coleman. Please put your hands together.
Sticks and stones hurt harder when you know they're thrown from no farther than your own sweet home. Then you fall flat on the welcome mat. You won't be welcome back. Walk that line. There's no way, you gotta choose a side. There's no gray, there's only black and white. And it just ain't right. If we fight, then it's just like painting in the rain. Walking in slow motion, trying to catch a moving train. Why we overdosing just to dull a little pain? Joining the parade just to march the other way. It's like painting in the rain, fighting for a difference, but we're never gonna change. Right foot lifted, left foot chained, eyes wide open, but denying what we see, we might as well be out painting in the rain. Painting in the rain, in the rain, painting in the rain. Paint the sky with dark words, it's either do or die. To be heard, you gotta risk your life. And if the walls don't crumble down and fall, you might just lose it or walk away. There's no danger when you play it safe. There's no anger if you just behave. But if we don't fight for our rights, then it's just like painting in the rain. Walking in slow motion, trying to catch a moving train. Why we overdosing just to dull a little pain? Joining the parade just to march the other way. Painting in the rain, fighting for a difference that we're never gonna change. Right foot lifted, left foot chained, eyes wide open, but denying what we see, we might as well be out painting in the rain. Thank you. motion, trying to catch a moving train. While we overdosing just to dull a little pain. Joining the parade just to march the other way. Yeah. It's like painting in the rain. Fighting for a difference, but we're never gonna change. Right foot lifted, left foot chained. Eyes wide open, but denying what we see. We might as well be out painting in the
Ladies and gentlemen, we have seen so much talent on stage here tonight. Please put your hands together one more time. Didn't I tell you this was gonna be one of your favorite parts of the show? Was I right? Well, guess what? We have so much more for you still. I hope everyone's still here, right? Okay, just making sure. I need to hear some more noise. Everyone's still here, right? Okay. Now, I just got word of what we have coming up next. Hold up, just have to. Okay, putting it in check. So, coming up next, we have the question and answer session. And I just got the question. Are we ready?
Yeah.
Hold up, let me just make sure so that we have it in check. This is a good one. Now, I'm glad you guys can't see my handwriting. All right, we're ready. So, coming up first, we have none other than Xavier Ramsey. Please welcome him to the stage. Make some more noise as it comes to the stage. Let them know that you're here supporting it. Good evening.
Good evening.
Is higher education necessary to be successful?
I believe that this is a very complex question. Because as we all hear from our parents, I want you to go to university. The only thing that I really want, well, most of our parents, I should say, I really want you to go to university. University is essential for you getting a job, you getting earnings that will help you to benefit your family and be able to support your family in the future. But as we've seen especially in the 21st century, unorthodox ways, also work. And we've seen many, 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 many entrepreneurs come about, including my uncle who runs several brands, including Jamie Madison Collection and Branded Bermuda, with skills that you can learn not only in a classroom, but also through real life experiences, whether that be through internships, or whether that be through you simply taking a course, maybe that somebody has maybe at City Hall one day that is free because people want to see the growth of other people. So I don't believe that higher education is necessary for success. It increases your likelihood for success based on society of we believe in that, oh, if you have higher education, therefore you are more qualified for a job. In many ways, we say that's not the case, but it is not necessary. Thank you.
Thank you. That was a great response. I've been even asking myself that question as I've been away in school, blessing to come back this summer. Okay, so coming up next, we have Daquan Trott from the Cedar Bridge Academy. Let's welcome him as he comes to the stage.
Good evening.
Good evening. Is higher education necessary to be successful?
I believe higher education is an option to be successful. I believe that yes, it is a nice step to go into, but I also believe that if you have a skill, a talent, or a trade, and you want to pursue it, you should do it. Entrepreneurs are very evident in our society today. And they are an example of what higher education isn't necessary to pursue in. We, as Promedians, say, oh, you need to go to higher education after high school. But that is not always true. You should always go from your heart. If you are not fully wanting to go into higher education, you shouldn't. Only go if you want to go. Because staying here to help your island out is not a problem. So I believe higher education is an option.
Thank you. Amazing. I'm loving it so far. Are you? Yes. This is a good question because, you know, especially not having a higher education here where you can't get anything really much greater than your associate's degree, right? It's a good question because you hit the end of high school and you're like, okay, what's that next step, right? So let's hear from our next beau this evening, Keanu Rollins from the Chatmore British International School. Please welcome him to the stage. Let's have another warm round of applause. Tanya, this question's tough. All right. Good evening. Is higher education necessary to be successful?
I don't believe higher education. May you repeat the question?
Sure. Is higher education necessary to be successful?
I don't think higher education is not for everyone to be successful because many people learn on the internet now and they're only finishing high school. Many people are trading online for their money and thank you.
Thank you. Hey, this is very true. Put your hands together once again. Okay, so coming up next, we have none other than Vincent Darrell. Please put your hands together. Make a warm welcome from the Soltis Grammar School. Good evening.
Good evening.
The question is higher education necessary to be successful?
Ladies and gentlemen, let's think of a world where You go to primary school, you go to secondary school, and then you're just thrown out into the world to survive for yourself. Without an opportunity to go to university and further your studies, I believe higher education is necessary. Because being able to practice the material that you were taught and being able to reinforce on that and build on those stepping stones to achieve and go into that career that you really desire and have a deep love for is very necessary. So ladies and gentlemen, what have I told you? I've told you that I believe higher education is necessary because it allows you to build on those stepping stones, ladies and gentlemen, and achieve that and obtain that knowledge for the career that you, of your choice. Thank you.
Thank you. Haven't we had some wise words here tonight, ladies and gentlemen? I'm telling you, I'm loving it. I'm taking this knowledge in as well myself. I hope you are too. Okay, so are we ready for our next bow? Please make some noise, are we ready? Okay, we're going to be having Seth Hartman from the Barclay Institute. Please make a warm round of applause. Bring him to the stage, please, thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
Is higher education necessary to be successful?
From experience, I believe that higher education is not necessarily is not necessarily needed for success, because I have seen a lot of people, even like from my prime example has to be my father. I see my father become such an amazing entrepreneur, and yes, he didn't go abroad to school; he went to Bermuda College, and it's not like he had a complete amazing set of education from a higher level. He just did what he had to do. He understood what it took, and he put the hard work in, and he instilled that in me. And I hope that that shows through me from my performance tonight. And I feel like, yes, a higher education is good for you, but it's not necessarily essential for higher education, but I mean for success.
This is it. I'm telling you, it's lovely to hear these perspectives, ladies and gentlemen. Are we enjoying it so far? Taking in all that knowledge, yes? Okay. And last but not least, we have Jaden Coleman, who's going to be coming to the stage next. Please bring a warm welcome to Jaden Coleman from the Bermuda Institute. Good evening.
Good evening.
Is higher education necessary to be successful?
Contrary to what many people may believe, higher education is not required for you to be successful. There are many people who have dropped out of high school and have made a life for themselves. Some become entrepreneurs, other just apply for certificates and certifications and work their best to get those. And because of that, they become more qualified than someone or some people in higher education. While it is very good to have a higher education, you do not need a higher education to be successful. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm loving these responses. Please put your hands together for all of our bows who have answered tonight. Amazing responses, yes. Now, I was told I had to stop talking about the question before, so like, really, that was a good question. What do you guys think? I mean, even in college, when I was away, I was thinking like, look, like I'm in my second, third year now. I still have to go back home. And I have friends who are back home who didn't go to college. Right? And it's still like, even if you have that degree, you can come back to Bermuda and it's not guaranteed. So at the end of the day, I feel like it's all about the actions that you put into place. And if you have a goal in mind, you can score.
You know what I mean? You don't, if you don't know the goal, you can't score. So that comes to anything, whether it's getting your degree, whether it's achieving that goal that you want and that you have in mind. So ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for your support so far tonight. You've been enjoying the show, right? Okay, so I remember when I was doing the Beautillion, the part that I was looking forward to the most, the part that brought all the guys together was the... You already know what's happening. Can anyone step in the audience? It's pretty hard. So as these young men come to the stage, I need for you to please welcome them and support them and show them that you're enjoying the step, because it's a lot of hard work that goes into that step. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together, please.
that'll make you bounce your ass. Cause I'm all white, man. Cause I'm all white. Mr. White, now you heard me box a million, y'all. This would be the remix.
Put your hands together one more time. I tell you, it ain't easy. It's not easy. Wow.
It's really hot up here, so I knew they were extra hot. Yeah, just like that. The 20th annual Alpha Battalion program is drawing to a close. I know some of you guys don't want to leave. Obviously, this was exciting for me. I hope it was exciting for you. I hope it was exciting for our judges. Let's give another round of applause to our judges. I know that Antoine introduced the judges earlier. I'm just going to once again say their names. We have Mr. Kia Saunders, the president of the Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority in Bermuda. We have Senator Lindsey Simmons. We have Gainette Jones, who's a CEO and founder and keynote speaker and podcaster and everything that's great about our Black women. And we have Jonathan White. He's actually my colleague. I appreciate the time that he's dedicated today towards the Alpha Battalion program. Over the course of these past 5 or so months, we've had a number of guests that have assisted in making sure that these students are ready for the Alpha Battalion program, and we have a number of presenters and community partners is what I would probably call them. And one community group that has been extremely instrumental in the development of these students today and assisting them with all their oratory needs and their introductions, their speeches, their Q&As, is the Bermuda Toastmasters. Let's give a round of applause to Bermuda Toastmasters. So this year we have been ably assisted by Ebony Frey and Kimberly Kane's Best. Ebony has been extremely instrumental with Miss Kimberly Kane's Best. And I would like to invite Ebony to the stage at this time because Ebony wants to make just a presentation to the Bows. She's been dealing with them for a number of years. And I said years, but it's really months, but it might seem like years to her. So I'm just gonna give an opportunity to make a presentation to the Bows.
Thank you, Dante. Good evening. Give these birds a round of applause. I smile every year. It has been years, Dante. It actually has been years. Bermuda Toastmasters has been partnering with the Beautillion for the past 8 years now. And I'm ably assisted usually by Miss Kimberly Kane's Best, who decided to have a baby. So hi, Kim. Hi, baby Micah. And so for the past 6 months, I've been with your boys, been with your birds. If you don't know, public speaking is a life skill, and Bermuda Toastmasters is focused on not only developing your communication skills, but also your leadership skills. Shameless plug for Bermuda Toastmasters. There are 4 clubs in Bermuda, 2 of which are public, which means you can join and plug in at any time if you want to develop your communication and leadership skills. All of that to say, for the past 6 months, the Birds have actually gone through a Toastmaster curriculum that we call Speechcraft. They've had real projects. They've gotten real feedback, whether they like it or not. I love to give evaluations, so they've gotten it. But again, it's only strengthening what we call a life skill, which is public speaking. The only way they're going to get better is by doing it. So whether they value those evaluations or not, hi, guys. They got them, which prepared them for their prepared speeches tonight, as well as their impromptu speeches and their intros. So without further ado, again, I do stand here as a Toastmaster. We do give awards on the night. We have some token prizes. Thank you for putting up with me for the past 6 months. And it's been through a pandemic, so give them a round of applause. I mean, sending them the Zoom link. All right, guys, we're on today. Again, giving them that feedback. I've seen some do-rigs and some hairlines when we had lockdown. So, I mean, they transform. Honestly, they come to us after school when we can meet physically, and they look like ragamuffins, and we see them. You're laughing. They're yours. You know what they look like. You know what they look like. But they get up here. They put on these tuxes. They put on this show. They compete for scholarship money, and they just grow because of it. So, again, a round of applause to all of our contestants. You guys did good. You guys did good. It doesn't make my job easy. I'm not an official judge, praise the Lord for that. But we do give prizes for who we think, based on what we take them through, the paces we put them through. There is, you know, equations for how you answer an impromptu speech or how you give a prepared speech. So taking all that information away for the 6 months that we've met, we do give little token prizes to who we think the best speech is and who we think the best impromptu speech is. I noticed Antoine didn't name his cop match team minus Somerset, so I know. Mixed emotions. I got some fans, I got some haters, that's fine. I always tell these guys, evaluations are opinion based. Tonight, I thought that the best prepared speech goes to Mr. Vincent Darrell of Saltus Grammar School. So I love you all to Vincent. So that's for our prepared speech, and for the impromptu speech, again, it is a formula for it. Maybe they'll tell you one day, maybe you'll come to a Toastmasters workshop, but tonight's best impromptu speaker was Mr. Seth Hartman of the Barclay Institute. And again, just for putting up with me, we do have some token awards, again, on behalf of myself, Kimberly. Yep, sure, you can hand them out. Thank you very much, Champagne. Think of us. I'm told don't burn them until Wednesday, so I guess you know what they are. But do enjoy. And thanks again for putting up with me, guys. I thought you did a great job.
It would be remiss of me if I did not also have a gift for Ebony. She has been with us for the last 7 years, Ebony and Kim, and Ebony has been extremely instrumental this year, taking on double roles for Kim, who is unable to be with us today. And I know that these gentlemen have definitely enjoyed the feedback she has provided. She's made herself available numerous times, invited us into her home via Zoom, obviously. And she's definitely assisted in preparing these students for tonight. So Ebony, on behalf of the Alpha Battalion program, we just want to give you a small token of our appreciation.
St. George's, Audie Bay. Audie Bay.
Okay, right now, the tabulator is just in the back, just obviously doing his tabulations. And I just know that the Minister of Education, the Honorable Diallo Rabane, he's also a brother of the Alpha fraternity, is in the audience. So I just wanted to give him the opportunity
Can I just see the house lights, please? Sorry. Okay. So just give an opportunity to obviously address everyone tonight.
Good evening and welcome. It's amazing. I'm actually here with a special guest. Our outgoing regional vice president of Alpha East is here as well, Brother Lucian Metellus. And so I do apologize for being late with you. I had to pick him up. But I remember when this competition started 20 years ago, and I was the chairman. So where Dante is standing, I was there. So I know what it's like trying to put this thing on. Actually, 20 years ago, it was his brother who was the winner of the Beautillion. I think he was the third or fourth winner. But it is a competition that builds character. It's a competition that shows our young men that they can do. I think the answers to the question, especially the impromptu question today, was absolutely fabulous. Every single one of you, give yourselves an applause for that. Obviously, as the Minister of Education, I agree wholeheartedly with what you said. Higher education, we need to think differently about what higher education is. Education is a lifelong thing. It's something that you're consistently learning, no matter what profession you go into. So when we look at things like what we're trying to do with the school system and insert that entrepreneurial curriculum from primary school throughout, when we look at inserting things within the high school that will have our children leaving high school with a skill that they can take into the workforce or onto higher education, this is where I look at the future and I see the future is very bright with these young men because they have it. Congratulations, guys. Congratulations for everything that you've accomplished. I know Seth, I met him he was at a basketball camp earlier this week. So we had a little bit of fun at that basketball camp. But I want to thank you for coming out. Thank you for showing your appreciation for these young men. Thank you for encouraging them to be the best young men that they can be. And as I said, the future is extremely bright when you look at what it is that we in Bermuda are producing and the type of young men that we are putting out there to go ahead and take their rightful place as leaders of our community. Thank you. And I'd like to call Brother Metellus to the stage. Not to speak, but because we're going to give out some prizes later.
We're in the process of an audit. The numbers are very close. Last year was extremely close. And I suppose I can use this time. There are some bows that are in the audience. Let me use this time for those bows that are in the audience to just come up here and to just reintroduce yourself and tell everybody what you're doing, where you're planning to go to school, if you're already in school.
Good afternoon. No, evening, sorry. My name's Yaiwan Darrell. I was at Alpha Bo last year in the 2020 competition. I just want to say congrats to everyone up here. Like, watching it from my seat right there, it was a very enjoyable show. I enjoyed everyone's presentations, and it's really nice to look back and be like, wow, I was in that position last year, and the quality has not gotten worse. It's gotten much better. And that's not dissing my bows from last year, but I'm just saying you guys are extraordinary. My plans for university, I'm going to King's College London to study political economy. As some of you might notice, that's my brother over there. A lot of people say we look alike, but we often say that we don't. but yeah, Thanks a lot, Dante, and thank you guys.
Is there any other boos in the audience?
Okay.
God bless one and all. For those who don't know me, my name is Jordan Simmons Trott. I was part of this program back in 2016. Mercy, 5 years ago. Yeah, 2016. I just graduated from the number one undergraduate university in Canada, Mount Allison, with a Bachelor's of Arts, with a major in English Literature and minor in Religious Studies. It is with great aspiration that I hope to be in the education system come this fall. I'm just waiting on my license. We're getting there. We're getting there. Yes, but same. This has truly been a thrill to, you know, come here every year to watch the boys come out and compete. And I was truly impressed with the question regarding education, regarding exactly success. Do you have to go off to school in order to be successful or to be here? And I hopefully come next year when there's no Save Key events. I work with a few young boys who I wanted to actually bring here to the event, and I think that question would have spoke a lot of volumes to them, because unlike some of us who have been given this opportunity here to thrive over here, they have not been, and so I think that would have been very powerful for them. But I could talk on and on, so I'm gonna cut it right now. But well done, congratulations, gentlemen, and God bless one and all. I'm out. Yeah.
We're almost there. Just want to also introduce and invite to the stage the immediate past Eastern Regional Vice President of our fraternity, Brother Lucian Metellus. He's on vacation here, and he's joined us for the Beautillion program. He just wants to obviously just give some words.
Well, good evening, gentlemen. I want to first congratulate the Epsilon Theta Lambda. For those of you that don't know, they've raised over $260,000 in scholarship in over these 20 years. And that's really something to be complimented. And I won't be before you long, but what I did want to tell the young men that stand behind me is that, you know, 20 is not a number that you should take for granted. 20 is the representation of platinum. And so if you get an opportunity to think about what platinum really is, platinum is that high-end metal. It's more it's more valuable than gold. And why is platinum that? Because you can't really scratch it very easily. You can't damage it. And so for all of you six young men, I want you to remember that no matter how hard life gets, you're platinum. Now, hopefully you'll be driving a car one day with platinum rims and everything else. But what I really want to just get to you is that you are the best of the best. And you, no matter who comes home with what today, just know that I am proud of all six of you. And I get to go, and I've been around the world, from Europe, Africa, Asia, United States and Bermuda. But what I can tell you is that every time I see young men like yourself, I know that Bermuda's future is great, and we're thankful for it. Thank you for your time.
The order is complete. I'm going to invite our MC out to the stage to give us the results. Drum roll.
All right, the time that we've all been waiting for. No, I was doing a little work back there. All right. So I'd like to call these three young men up to the stage first, just to congratulate them this evening on their participation and just doing an amazing job. I'd like to bring up to the stage first, Keanu from Chatmore.
British International School. Jaden Coleman from Bermuda Institute. Seth Hartman from the Barclay Institute. All right. Can I get a little drum roll going? Yeah, okay. Don't worry, it's all good. Okay. From, drum roll, can we get the drum roll now, yeah? Okay, from the Cedar Bridge Academy, Daquan Trott, second runner-up. Okay, drum roll again. All right, from, drum roll. The Warwick Academy, Xavier Ramsey. Put your hands together. Our first runner up. Don't need this no more. And what we've all been waiting for, okay. From the Soltis Grammar School, Vincent Darrell.
Ladies and gentlemen, it goes without saying that all these young men deserve a rousing round of applause. They have sacrificed countless hours. We've been here at the City Hall since Tuesday rehearsing for tonight, and I hope that it should. These young men, I'm speaking to them backstage, they're all proud of how they came out today and how they represented their schools and their families. So just give them another rousing round of applause. Before we close for the evening, it's customary that when we end the Beautillion show, we invite the brothers of the fraternity to come on stage, and we're gonna try and to just make a half circle behind these young men. So at this time, if we can just get the brothers of the fraternity that are in the audience, you can just come up.
Precepts, thy banner shall be raised.
affection slowly fades away. Hurry now, they and if eternal bond, may they ever abide and with us stay. Alpha, Phi Alpha, the pride of our hearts, and love by us dearly art thou. We cherish thy precepts, thy banner shall be raised to thy glory, thy honor and renown.
O Lord, may the true spirit of fraternity rule our hearts, guide our thoughts, and control our lives, so that we may become through thee servants of all. Amen.
Hey, boy! Move!
Ladies and gentlemen, and that is the end of the 20th NU Alpha Battalion program. Thanks again.